Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Understanding God's Loving Laws group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the session 1 review, conclusion, and homework presentation, Mary reviews and concludes the foundation principles session and gives some homework to the participants for the following day. Recorded on the 6th of November 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
All right. So now we have a bit of time allocated just to review all of those beautiful principles that you've learnt about from Jesus the last couple of days, and to talk about the other presentations, as Jesus mentioned, and also to hopefully just sort of encapsulate for you the spirit of what it is that we've been learning about, or the fact that these are foundational principles. And then I'll give you some homework to have a look at over the next day. And I think your homework is a great opportunity to keep learning about the principles and to think about what they really mean. I like the homework that we've designed for you guys, because it gives you an opportunity to really reflect on each principle in practice, if you like. Okay, so the foundation principles, so the 10 principles that we've grouped together in this first 2 days, can you see that they really form the basis of all of creation? All of creation is created, and the whole universe really can exist because these principles exist. They're guided or directed by these principles. And they also give us the opportunity, don't they, to experience love. And also to, if you've noticed through the principles, there's a theme of experiencing trust and safety. Did you notice that? So that's a really lovely thing that God's created this basis for us, isn't it? And they affect all of creation and govern all of law. Okay, so let's go back right to the very beginning, that Jesus started you guys off with this diagram. And remember, the very first thing that we talked about was that God is what kind of being? Infinite. So being the infinite being, that means that God, we have to exist within God, don't we? We have to exist within God. So this is, and but then we talked about the fact that God has a character, a personality, attributes. Remember that? Yep. And it's just, if you think about it, it's like me. I have a character and a nature and attributes. Nothing to the measure of God, because God, you remember, infinite and perfected in all of her attributes and qualities. But if you can sort of consider it, it's similar to yourself. You have attributes, don't you? And a character and nature. This is on an infinite scale in a perfected way. And then we talked about the fact that God has principles. And if you think about it, these principles are not really separate from God's nature. They're really a reflection of God's nature. Can you see that? It's like you yourself, because of your nature and character and personality, there's certain principles that you live by and create by, aren't there? There's ways that there's desires that you have, there's ways that you go about creating. And they're based on principles, which is governed by your character and nature. And that's exactly the way it is with God. Except, of course, it's infinite and perfected. This is how it differs greatly from us. But if you can get the analogy. So these are things that are infinite. God's nature, personality, and the principles that are a reflection of that nature and personality. But then we have laws that are governed by these principles. And this is why we're talking about the principles, because if you learn about the principles, everything about the laws kind of becomes logical, because you understand the broader principle. But the laws aren't infinite, and the laws are specific in their operation. Do you understand that? Because one of the questions we had in private was, well, these foundation principles, they all affect all laws. So what makes a law unique from another law? Well, that's in its operation. It does different things. And you've learned a bit about that in your education so far, about the law of attraction and the law of compensation and all of these other laws that have kind of specific operation and specific things that happen with them in the universe. But they're all governed by these principles. So they can't go in disharmony or discord with these principles, these foundational principles. Got that? Yeah. And as we're going to learn more in our next session, all of these laws exist within a hierarchy. Okay. And so these laws now govern all of creation. So that's from the most complex that Jesus talked about, the human soul, right the way down to the very smallest particle. So that was the basis of what he wanted to show you in this, in his very first introduction. Is everyone clear on that? I haven't kind of said it in a slightly different way to try and help you kind of conceptualize how it all sits together. Yeah. Okay. All right. So as I mentioned, these foundation principles form the foundation of the universe itself, the foundation of everything that God's created. And learning about them, we can learn some basic facts about God's personality and nature, which if you think about it, if you think about all the principles you've heard about in the last couple of days, tells us a lot about what God values, doesn't it? What God feels is important. And as Jesus kept reinforcing to you, every principle is really a reflection of love, something that's loving. So we're learning a lot about the nature of God's love, aren't we? That it's economical and that, you know, it has a lot of different aspects to it that we might have called separate, but it's really all about love. Okay. Okay. And these foundation principles ensure that law allows for our existence to experience love and to live in a state of safety and security within the universe. Right. So, who can tell me the first two principles that we discussed? David?
Love and truth.
Yes. Yep. And who can tell me the second two? Nat.
Life and development.
Yep. And remember, each of these two ones went together. They were kind of like little couples, weren't they? Married together. They had a lot of similarities that we started to see as they were discussed. Life and development. What were the next two? Amber. And if we go to Felix on the other side for the final two.
Economy and function.
Yep. And Felix, what were the final two?
Permanence and scope.
Yes. And who felt really excited about permanence and scope? About eight people. Who felt like, whoa, permanence and scope, there's a lot there I need to revisit. Yeah. Yeah. The majority. It's really difficult, obviously, we're just giving you a flavour, as Jesus mentioned a lot of times, of what these things are about, but it will require your investigation to really grasp them. And as he mentioned, we had a great many awesome discussions about all of the implications of each of these principles and how they affect each law, the operation of each law, and how they're reflected in the operation in so many laws. And so I'm really looking forward to the opportunity to film some of those discussions again, because I know it'll help all of you. But you guys can have your discussions in private on your day off and start to nut it all out as well. Okay. And we had two other presentations. The first one was fundamental facts. And what was the one you had today? Who can tell me that one? Dahlia?
Was it the human laws?
Human law comparison. Yes. Yeah. And that's the first of three that are going to go together to kind of help you guys explore the emotions that you have that are blocking you from really embracing all of these principles and the laws, living in harmony with the laws. So that was a good intro, hey? All right. So Let's just quickly have a look again at fundamental facts. I don't have much time to go over it, and we've touched on some of it already. We talked about God being infinite, that God's personality, characteristics, attributes, and desires, they govern God's principles of law. So they're the things that make God decide what are the principles I'm going to create by, under which I create. And then the principles govern the laws. So they govern what the laws do, how they're created. The operation of the law cannot go outside, cannot oppose the principle. Make sense?
Yep.
The laws govern creation. Billions of laws exist. It's impossible for us to learn them all very quickly in a week, but we can start to open up to the principles, which will help us be almost intuitive about the laws. Okay? And understanding law requires following God's way and receiving God's love. Can you see how that's kind of logical as well? Because if we're acting in disharmony with the way, it's very hard for us even to grasp what the law is going to be all about. I can feel there's more questions about that. We don't have time for them today, but hopefully you'll be able to raise some of that with Jesus as the week progresses. Okay. Human law comparison. There's a little slide up there with a few different things on there, but basically the main point I reckon I was going to just review with you guys was the final point on the screen, which is if I keep treating God's laws like human laws and with the same emotions that I have towards human laws and the same misconceptions I have about love and how that interacts or how I relate to law, I'll continue to remain unhappy and in pain. And as I said, this is the first of three discussions we're going to have with you about this topic, and hopefully it's opening you up to that fact that pain and suffering is directly related to the attitude you have towards law. More injured the attitude, the more pain and suffering, because the more sin actually exists. But Jesus will talk more about that with you later on. All right, so let's quickly review the principles. Our first principle was love. Okay. So remember we learned, and I've just got some notes here about different points that I found you guys were really kind of hitting upon or a bit stuck upon as we went through each principle. So remember we said love governs all principles. Love and truth, remember Jesus said, it's sort of like the basis for everything. The Siamese twins, we called them in the previous group. And it ensures that all of creation experiences God's love. And remember how he talked to us about the fact that even if we're not in a direct personal relationship with God, we are actually right now experiencing some of God's sort of non-personal love. The love that God has for all of creation is actually, we are experiencing that in our ability to live and learn and grow and experience. And a lot of us don't really think about that very much, do we? Another thing that you guys were a bit challenged by was this point about the fact that love is enforced, compelled, and upheld in this universe. And a lot of you felt like, isn't that like a contradiction in terms? How can love be enforced and upheld? And a lot of times that's because on earth, when we do something and then someone enforces or compels something upon us, it's like they're doing it with a big lack of love and pulling upon our will. Whereas what's happening with these love principles, it means that every law is non-negotiable. Love is enforced. It's not like something happens and everything gets out of harmony with love and then it's pulled back in harmony with love. It is enforced. Now we can use our will out of harmony with love, but for all of the universe, love is always going to be upheld because of the operation of the laws. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. And also that this principle means that all of creation, all of God's creation, demonstrate some of God's love, which is pretty beautiful, isn't it, if you think about it? Yeah. Okay. Next principle was truth. What was the cool thing about truth? Does anyone remember something really massively amazing? Michael Bailey?
It's very closely linked to love.
Yes. It's like love and truth facilitate each other, don't they? Without truth, we can't have love. Without love, we can't have truth. So truth provides a framework, really, for love. And that's a really essential thing. And remember, Jesus talked to us about the fact that you can't be untruthful and also be loving. And he said that many times in many ways, but I feel that this understanding these two principles together, it really starts to highlight how that's actually physically and scientifically impossible. Yeah. Yeah. Another great thing he said with regard to truth principles was that God deals in facts. Nothing else. And while we have emotional condition, that's a fact within us. It's not, we can't fudge it or tell ourselves we have some other emotion. It's factual, the actual state that we're in. Someone got a little shudder. But it's great, actually, because there's sort of certainty in that, isn't there? We can work to change it, and when change happens, it's real. What was another thing that he said about the relationship between truth and fear? Does anyone remember? Amber?
Truth and fear are completely opposite and oppose each other.
They do. Yep, they do. He also said, Yvonne, you want to have a go?
He also said that they're both emotions.
Yes, yes. That truth is actual, it's scientific, but it's also emotional. And a lot of us hadn't really thought about that either, had we? We can see fear is emotion, but truth is the opposite of fear, and therefore it's also emotional, an emotion. All right. What was our next one? Oh, just on that, we also said that being in harmony with truth ensures fearlessness. And that was quite a crucial point that he made, wasn't it? Yeah, yeah. Okay, next principle was life. Life. Okay. So this principle ensures that life energy is given to all living creatures, but it also means that life is promoted, nurtured, respected, and sustained by all law. So remember, there was a great discussion where Jesus had on the board, and he was explaining to you guys how life energy has been given to the soul at the time it was created by God. And there was a lot of lovely aha moments where a lot of you were realizing, wow, it's the damage in my soul that affects the way that energy flows in my soul, which then affects the life energy or the energy that flows in my body, my physical and spirit bodies. Because a lot of times we think of the physical body as having the life energy. And it was a big kind of aha for a lot of you to go, oh, it's in the soul. And from that, you can see that the emotional work that we're always talking about, clearing the soul damage, if you like, that's the only way you're ever going to feel an improvement in your physical body. Yeah. Okay. But also, it wasn't just about the life energy. It was about law promoting and nurturing and sustaining life. So there was two ways that we looked at the life principles there. And the great thing about life principles, there's many, but was that imbalance is prevented and repaired, and that matter is always transformed into more life-promoting material. There's a lot of examples we have in nature, but we also talked a little bit about how spiritual experiences, emotional experiences also do that. Okay. How are we all going? It's late in the day, after lunch. All right. Next principle. Development. Yep. And what was something really awesome about the development principles? Anyone have anything that really stood out to them there? Yes, Pamela? Just if you wait.
You can have permanency and change and development.
Yes, so this is where there was some clarification, wasn't there, with one of the later principles, which was about permanence. There was a little bit of confusion feeling that the principle of development meant that development was developing, or that the principles of God develop. But remember, every principle governs law, and law governs creation. And what the development principle states is that all law shall promote development in creation. So not that it promotes development in law. Yeah, but it was a good point to clarify, wasn't it? Yeah. Yeah. Okay. And so this expansive change is forced upon matter was very important. But a lovely thing about development means that all of God's creation, all of God's created laws, means that our growth is supported, encouraged, and sustained. That's another thing that can really promote trust for us, can't it? The fact that, wow, every law that God has for me is about supporting, every law that God has created is about supporting my growth. That's a very loving provision. Yeah. Okay. Next principle. Economy. Who had some good aha moments in the economy principle? A couple of people, yeah. Yes. Yep. Rita, do you want to share yours?
Economy means abundance. That's the opposite of the world's definition.
Yes, that was a really key point, wasn't it? That God's economy ensures abundance. Because there is an equal value placed upon the time involved with something, the matter, and the energy it takes to create something or to enforce something or to manage something. There's an equal value on the time, matter, and energy involved. And because of that, there's always abundance. And remember, Deirdre asked that great question about, well, then why are we all so hung up on time? And Jesus talked about that's because we're not valuing the other resources and we're believing that time is limited. Yeah. And that causes an imbalance in our ethics and morality. But that God's economy is always ethical and moral. So we could almost say, couldn't we, that if we are ethical and moral, if we have equal value of resources involved, so not just ours but everyone involved, we will ensure abundance. Okay. All right. I think that was the key bits there. Again, we don't have tons of time for this one. What was our next principle? Function. Okay. And what was a really key thing from the function discussion? Or what was something that you really felt you connected to in the function discussion? If we come to Teresa.
Things that we create need to have not just one function or not just look pretty. To have a lot of functions.
Yeah, so if we say that a different way, we learnt that God never has just one function for something, didn't we? And if so, as you said, if we want to be in harmony with that principle, then we'll start to create in the way that God does. Mm. Yes, yeah. So we saw that God actually values equally what the thing does or what the thing creates or the results of the thing, how beautiful the thing is, and how many resources go into that creation or that function. So it's similar, isn't it, to economy in that way, this this way that things are valued up, but this value of the results and the use of the resources and the beauty as equal is very, very, well, we could say it's very, very neglected on Earth, couldn't we? Yes. And that's why there's so many things that don't function very well. And this is why also I saw a couple of you had some questions about, well, how is beauty and function mutually inclusive in God's creation? This is how it happens. It means that they're not, one doesn't exclude the other, as it often does on Earth. Often something that's very functional, you know, like health sandals. Very functional, they're there to look after your feet and everything. How often are they very beautiful? Not so much. So we often on Earth have this feeling that function and beauty are mutually exclusive. Whereas in God's creation, function and beauty are mutually inclusive, which is really exciting to me. You know, that's a beautiful thing. And if we look around us, we start to see that in God's creation. And Jesus talked about the true artists who think of both function, design, beauty, the whole thing together. And that was challenging for many people in the audience as well, who like to paint or draw or things like that. But what a great challenge for us, because we know that if there's multiple functions automatically fulfilled in our creations, we start to live in harmony with so many laws, don't we? And if we honour the other principles like love and truth and economy in those creations, that does mean that we are starting to create far more like God creates, which is going to mean good things. Yeah. Okay. And the lovely thing that is also involved in the function principles is that each of God's creations has an instinctive desire to fulfill all of the outcomes. So by that we mean that intuitively or instinctively within the creation, this desire to use things economically to fulfill the function and to be beautiful is already in the natural workings of each creation. Everything in that creation is working to do that. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Just checking my time. Permanence is our next principle. Who had a good aha with permanence? Yeah, a few of you. Inga, do you want to tell us what yours was?
There is no chaos in the creation of God. Yeah. Except for the one weak horse.
Yeah. Yeah. The human will is the wild card, isn't it? Yep. What was someone else's big aha? Deirdre?
That God wants us to trust God, and it's a foreign concept, but
yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and actually really permanence is saying that it's showing us that we can trust, isn't it? And you know what else permanence shows me is that because things are unchangeable, consistent and self-enforcing, all of the laws are like that, it shows that means that everything is quantifiable, it's repeatable, isn't it? If I do a certain thing over and over again in exactly the same way, there's going to be a repeat of the results. What that says to me is I can learn, so God wants me to learn. God wants me to know truth. God designed everything. God's desire, which is reflected in his principles, is that I learn. And so all of God's laws, which are governed by that principle, are there to help me learn truth. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. And Karina, you had one?
I can measure my growth.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Which is good. Oh, everyone had great ideas. Pamela? And then we'll go to Rita.
Oh, sorry, I just lost it.
That's all right. Rita?
nothing can be destroyed, only unloving things or unloving creations.
Yeah, that was a bit of a theme that came through, wasn't it? That in a lot of these foundation principles, Jesus kept reminding us that the things that we create out of harmony with the principle are immediately going to be destroyed. But the things that God has created aren't really destroyed. Sometimes they're broken down, though, aren't they? Yeah. But the laws themselves don't change.
So even when earth changes would happen, it would be a loving principle, because nothing unloving, only unloving things get destroyed.
Yes, that's a little bit of a yes. You're kind of taking, remember how Jesus said when you want to just make things about the physical and not, because remember there's the earth itself is a part of the bigger universe, and so there's the soul condition and the spirit bodies of people. People might pass who are loving, but they won't be destroyed. They'll just pass into the spirit world. Yeah. Yeah. So just be careful about sort of drawing in too strong an analogy there. That's not really, that's very physical based rather than looking at the whole of the universe and creation. Okay. All right. Yes. This is another principle that really shows us that life can be safe and predictable if we learn the laws. Yeah. Okay. Scope principles. Now, some of the important things to grasp from the scope principles were that within all of God's creation, there's rules that govern how that creation operates. They're inbuilt into the creation. And then there's other rules, which we call external rules for the purposes of explaining, that govern how creations interact and how they can come together, how they can communicate, how they can multiply, how they can form into other creations or other matter. And each new matter that's formed has its own inbuilt rules again. And a lot of you I know were just like, oh. It's a big concept, but actually at its basis it's about inbuilt rules and external rules in creation that then allow for change and growth and new creation. But just grasping the fact that there's inbuilt rules and external rules within all of creation is a good start. Did anyone have any big ahas in the scope discussion? That's all right. Diana?
Just that you can break it down to the smallest particle and build from that. And that to me is pretty amazing way of creating and making things.
Yes. And if you think about scope, it's really showing us what provision for change God has made, doesn't it? It shows that there's a massive provision for us to change in one direction or another direction, and not just us, but all of creation. Because remember, you talked a lot with Jesus about the human soul in terms of scope, but this affects all of creation. So there's a massive potential for change. So there's provision, if I should say, provision for change in all of creation. But then there's also a certain limit on that change, how far it can go, which is a loving limit. Scope really challenged me when we wrote it. I had some really good discussions with Jesus about, but hang on. Are you saying, oh, I get it now. No, I don't get it. So, so I understand a lot of you feeling a little bit like challenged, but what I've found is if you sit with it, allow it to hit your emotions, why it's freaking you out or upsetting you or why you're feeling challenged by it, let yourself identify that emotion, have a feel of that emotion, come back to it. Usually it's much, much clearer. and really try to grasp the basics. Jesus has written it beautifully, I feel, in your outlines, to just really grasp the basics of what it's about. And once you establish them inside of yourself, then you can start to expand on that and ponder about it. But don't get too ahead of yourself, because you'll end up freaking out about the thing that you didn't feel about in the beginning. Does that make sense? Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So really, scope is about these inbuilt rules, external rules, and it provides provision or potential for combinations of matter and interactions between matter and creatures, creatures and creatures, and systems is really what it's doing. Yeah. Yeah. Okie doke. So let's get on to your homework. You've all read what your homework is. Yep. So it is, how am I living in or out of harmony with each of the foundation principles? Does anyone have any questions about what we mean by the question? Yeah? Do you want to ask them? Yeah. Salia?
Well, yes, I was just going to say, what do you mean? And, like, is there a specific context of that that you want us to focus on?
Okay. So really the question is, what is the question? And that's kind of the question for everyone. Yeah, okay. So if you look at your outlines, remember Jesus has only been able to go through with you a summary in each of these, hasn't he? And I just might see if I can bring up one of the... now, just let me remember how to do this. Yep. Sorry, guys. I'll just have a quick look to see if I can find an actual outline. No, I don't have it in this slideshow. Okay. In your outlines, you've got a definition, don't you? And you've got objectives for each of the principles. Now, the summary, the definition, the objectives, they're all to help you grasp what this principle is as a part of God's nature and personality. So this is a reflection. We're trying to explain to you what God's valuing, what God is really, what we really mean by this principle. So, for example, for truth, you know, truth is enforced and compelled. That's what God feels is really important in the way that God creates, designs, and does things. So in that example, you can ask yourself, is truth that important to me? Because if it is, I'd be in harmony with the principle. Do I, in my life, do I compel truth through my actions? So not in an unloving way, but do I create environments, relationships, rules in my family, laws that mean that truth is honored, compelled, enforced? That would be an example of a question you could ask yourself to see if you're living in or out of harmony with the truth principle. Does that make sense? So basically you're asking yourself, how am I in harmony with what this principle is all about? Or how am I out of harmony with it? Does that make sense? Still a few puzzled faces. Well, the economy principle is a really great example. Some of you have already been asking yourself, haven't you? How am I in or out of harmony with economy? So if we go back to that slide, whoops. Keep pressing the wrong button. Rookie mistakes. There we go. How much do I value time above matter and energy? Or how much am I, you know, willing to do a lot of work, spend 10 hours in my day just to save $20? You know, how much am I shoveling my own dirt or well, I can't think of a good example right now, but how much am I expending in time versus what I could be spending money on to give myself time? How much am I valuing these resources as equal? Dallin?
Yeah, babe, I think too, if everyone looks at that statement, it doesn't include money.
No.
So what I feel people need to have a look at there is like, okay, the equal value of resources is time, matter and energy. It's not money. Money's not even there. It's not even in the list. So why is it that I keep making decisions based on money all the time rather than making decisions based on time saving or matter saving or energy saving?
Yes.
That's a good question to ask.
That's a good question. Mm. Thank you, honey. Yeah. Yep. How much have I set up systems, so this point, the automation of laws and creations, how much have I set up systems in my life so I don't have to keep creating the same tasks over and over again? How much have I got routines or ways of doing things within our family or our relationship, which means that we actually use less energy or matter? Yeah? Felix, you had a question? Yep.
Does this homework also include reflecting on, where I haven't done so and then looking at the effects of it? Yeah.
Yes. That's a great thing. Yeah. This is all about your learning to reflect, how am I in or out of harmony with the principles and what have been the consequences of that? That helps us to grow faith. Whenever we look at the consequences, it helps us to grow faith in God's way. Yeah. If we just have a look at development, so part of the development principle is that growth is supported, encouraged, and sustained. How many of you in your personal relationships, in the way you structure your life, in your relationship with your kids, actually support and encourage growth? Do you have a lifestyle for yourself where you are encouraging your own growth? Are you challenging yourself to grow, creating situations and interactions to support your own growth? And with your kids, are you supporting their growth or are you trying to stunt their growth because it challenges you? In your relationships, how much do you support the growth of your partner? Or do you feel like, no, I'd prefer you to stay keeping my addictions, meeting my addictions? And or are you're not being supportive of their growth if you're bossing them into growth? That's not, remember, love is in all of these principles. So, yeah. Okay, so that's something to look at as well. You're starting to get the idea? Yep. How much, the life principles, how much do I promote and nurture life in my environment? So even in my physical environment around me, in my garden or, everywhere. Am I promoting it or controlling it, directing it, you know? Am I, and with, say, things like scope, how much am I honouring the inbuilt rules and working in harmony with the inbuilt rules of the creation, of God's creation? Or how much am I trying to override the inbuilt rules of God's creation by putting, I don't know, more paint on my house when when the wood is decaying because of an inbuilt rule and I'm treating it with some more chemicals and things like that? Jesus?
And there you can also look at the soul as well. I should probably stand up because I'm meant to. sorry about that, guys. I'm allowed to make rules and break them. Is that what I think? we can look at it from the perspective of the soul as well, because for many of us, we've learnt already that the soul's methods of communication and what it deals with is with emotions.
Yes.
So every time you're trying to control emotion, trying to fake emotion, trying to, you know, deliver emotion to somebody thinking that you're getting away with some law or something like that, in other words, trying to portray yourself or manipulate the emotion of others, you're really breaking the inbuilt rules relating to the soul. So this is something we need to consider too. How much are we breaking the inbuilt rules in our soul? And then we're hoping for positive outcomes, but how can there be positive outcomes? Because we're already breaking the inbuilt rules of how the soul works.
Yeah.
Yeah, things like that.
And in fact, for all of your principles and all of the homework, I've given you a lot of physical examples, but it's very good if you can start to apply each of the principles to your soul and the emotional aspects involved in each principle. That will help you a lot. Yeah. Okay. So is everyone a little bit clearer now on what we're asking there? And you can see, can't you, how this is going to help you really reflect on what is this principle all about. And you've got your outline there, your full outline there, to help you look more deeply at what each principle really does, what it's there to uphold and enforce. Because you can ask yourself, how much am I upholding that in my these particular things, these particular qualities in my own life? So that'll help you a lot to establish the real meaning. Jesus?
Sorry to interrupt again, but the purpose of this is really, and maybe I should come up with you rather than saying it here, sorry. The purpose of this homework is to help you to start to see your sin. Can you see that every time you're out of harmony with a principle, you're actually sinning? You're like against lots and lots and lots of laws.
Go on. Yeah, each principle is governing all
billions of laws.
Each of these foundation principles governs all law. So you can see that the minute you're out of harmony with just one of them,
you're breaking billions of laws immediately. Does that make sense? Does that sort of shock you a bit?
But if you bring yourself in harmony with the principle,
then you're automatically obeying billions of laws.
You don't have to learn the laws.
Don't even have to learn them anymore, right? So can you see the benefit? Now remember, in our next group following this one is going to be about sin, you see. And can you see the relationship? If I don't know how I'm sinning, then you're not going to see the seriousness of the sin or why the sin creates so many negative consequences, why it creates so much pain and suffering and so forth. So this is a very important question we need to constantly ask ourselves. It's something Mary and I, it's a daily occurrence for us, asking ourselves, what principles am I living in or out of harmony with here? Because obviously if I am, there's a whole series of laws that have been broken here, and it would behoove me, if I wanted to be happy, to bring myself into harmony with those principles rather than remaining out of harmony with them. So this question is going to require, like we say there, is going to require this really honest self-examination. Get used to this honest self-examination because it's going to help your progress a lot. Because you can imagine if you're living in harmony with one principle, now there's a potential of you living in harmony with billions of laws just by living in harmony with that one principle. And then if you live out of harmony with that one principle, there's the potential that you're now breaking billions of laws. And that obviously is going to have all sorts of detrimental effects on your soul. Do you see? So you can see the reason for the question. It's such an important question, far more important than I think most of you have really realised when you've read your outline as to why that question is so important. And it's also the reason why we've put that question in every homework that you've got. Because it's such an important question that needs to be, I feel, a part of your life permanently, that question. Where you're always looking at how things are going, how you're living in harmony. As soon as you notice some harmony or disharmony, what are you going to do about it? How you treat that? What your attitude is toward it? All of those things are very important things to examine.
After a while, as you begin to love the principle and really come to understand it emotionally, you'll start to instinctively feel, whoa, there I am, I'm in harmony or out of harmony with this principle. And you start to feel, just as Jesus said, the gravity of being in or out of harmony with the principle. And it becomes, you're less tempted to break the principle because you have more of an appreciation for, well, goodness, every time I'm out of harmony with this principle, it doesn't matter even if I can't even see what the negative effects would be, like obviously right now. I just know logically that there's going to be many, many flow-on negative effects for not only me but everyone else if I break this principle.
Mm.
And that's awesome when you can get to that point, because it makes decision making a lot easier.
Hmm. It also means you don't have to spend all this time trying to discover each individual law that you're breaking. You know that if you can bring your life into harmony with these fundamental principles, and also with the order principles, and eventually with the soul specific principles, then you're obviously already in harmony with the majority of God's universal systems. And this means that you're automatically going to start benefiting in your life. And it also means that your creations for the future are not going to be trying to correct or undo what you're currently doing, but rather they will support what you're currently doing. So this is where a lot of us, you know, we start creating something thinking it's fantastic and we think it's wonderful, but it's out of harmony with many of the principles, only to have God already start destroying it because of the laws, just trying to destroy it, trying to deconstruct it.
So then you're fighting the infinite being. And who's going to win?
And considering that you're living inside of him, there's not much chance of you fighting him, right, in the long run.
And winning. You can fight because you've got that will, but it doesn't work.
Yeah. So, yeah, I feel they're really good questions. And
I feel they're wonderful questions. Just one question, but very powerful.
Mm.
So that probably brings us to the end of session one. And just reminding you, session one was all about the foundation principles. So these 10 principles are like the foundation of all of creation. And you can tell by now in the way that we've discussed them that having a good grasp of them is going to give you a really good foundation for your own learning and understanding of God's character and nature.
Mm.
Our next session is going to be order principles. Is that the slide? Yep. Actually, our next session is going to be order principles, and that's going to be more about your soul, so more about your soul and how it fits into creation and the effect that your soul has on creation. So this foundation principles has been a lot about just principles that affect all of creation, that govern all of creation and all of law. And this next one, we're going to get a little bit more specific about your personal soul, how it fits into everything, and the effect that it can have on everything else. Should be really interesting.
Mm.
Yeah. But I'll see you again in a couple of days, because we'll go through your homework. And what I'd really like to do in that session, because again, it's a short session, and I'm supposed to be reminding you of 10 principles again.
8 principles, but yeah.
I'll keep saying 10, sorry. I thought of that after I'd said it last, sorry. 8 principles. And that's probably because I was like, oh, I've got to get through 10.
There's 10 talks.
10
yeah.
talks, yeah. So 8 principles. But I'd love for our review of those principles really to happen through hearing your homework, because your homework should be reflecting the principles and how you've thought about the principles. And I would love for us to be able to do that in a really interactive way. So I'll aim for that.
And there's about, I think it works out, doesn't it, about 4 minutes or so for the majority of the principles. So in that time, you're going to have to be succinct, direct to the point. And Mary won't be saying much in terms of review, but she wants to use your comments about what you reflected about as a review of those points. Does that make sense?
Do you understand? So I've got 4 minutes for love, 4 minutes for truth, 4 minutes for, you know. So if you guys can tell me what you reflected on about love in those 4 minutes, that will help me just highlight, yep, that's what the love principle was all about, and we'll move on, and so on. Yeah.
So it probably means that these are banned.
Yeah.
Doesn't it? Stories are banned. You're going to have to be quite succinct and
absolutely. Yeah. If you can be direct, I think it'll be great. I'm really looking forward to hearing your reflections.
Yeah.
So have a lovely day off. Hope you've enjoyed the first session. I thought Jesus did a champion job, but I always do. Yeah. He talked for a long time yesterday, hey? It was a big, big session. Yes. Yeah, so.
Felt like I talked a long time.
And yeah. Thank you all for your participation, and thank you very much for using the question sheets so diligently.
Very good, guys. Your questions are you know, got a lot more reflection in them as a consequence. And I think as a group, what have you found? Have you found they're more engaging as a result?
Yes.
Yeah. You're not hearing all this waffle and selfish talk and whatever. Yeah. It's getting to the point. And many of the questions then you go, oh, yeah, you know, that's an interesting question then, you know, rather than feeling like, oh, I can ignore that question. It's just about their life.
Yeah. What I'll do is, I know there's a lot of pressure to get your question written down at the start of the sessions. We'll try and open the door 20 minutes before we're going to start. And what I'll do in the break day is print off, so there'll be four folders. So instead of two, you'll have four. So hopefully that will cut down the wait time. Someone suggested taking the folders outside, but I'd actually prefer just to keep them in the room so there's no possibility of things getting lost and so on. So that's the system we'll have starting from day three in a day's time. Yeah. Mm. Yeah.
So as you can imagine, we've got a lot more interesting things to present. And you guys have already looked at the outline, so you know there's a lot of other things coming up in the outlines. But we're going to build upon the foundation principles now. So we're going to presume that you understand them relatively well, and particularly when it comes to the order principles, you'll need to understand scope relatively well. Otherwise, you're going to really founder when it comes to the governance and hierarchy stuff that we're going to talk about. So we really want to make sure over the break, if you're really struggling with scope, that you spend a bit of time on it, contemplating and pondering about it and so forth, so that you can get it enough so that when it comes to hierarchy, we don't get too bogged down in the fact that we have to revisit scope. Does that make sense? Yeah.
So if you can focus, remember Jesus got into this discussion on the board about matter combining and new rules and external rules and inbuilt rules and all of that. Before you get to really pondering that, if you can just grasp, okay, what do we mean by inbuilt rules? Sit with that. It's well explained in your outline. Just sit with that and try and understand that. Then go, okay, what's external rules?
And also, I feel energy and properties. That's something that you also do need to understand.
Yeah.
Because we are going to be referring to energy and properties down the track as well. So.
Yeah.
So if you can understand some of those basic terms, that'd be fantastic.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Go well.
Yeah.
Go well.
Yeah.
We'll see you in a couple of days, hey?
Yeah.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks, guys.